Welcome back to Christopher's Knowledge Discovery. I hope you're all doing well. Today's video is going to be about beauty and the beauty of nature for the existence of God. I found the concept for this video when I was running about 3 weeks ago on a beautiful sunny day. And I was just hit by the beauty of nature and beauty itself, and I thought about how we can explain for the existence of the beauty that exists itself and that exists in nature. And I sat down and I thought and I did some research and thought I'll bring this to you. The first question that has to be dealt with is, what is beauty? How do we define it? There's a dictionary definition, but to me it seems, pardon for the language, seems kind of lame. It's not enough for me to explain beauty just by the dictionary. The philosophical explanation that was given by Plato, quote, "Beauty is the sign of another higher order," end quote. So it got me thinking that in order for beauty to exist, all the right components have to exist exactly at the same time in order for that moment to be beautiful. The late great Roger Scruton defined beauty as a value like truth and goodness. A seemingly objective quality that beauty has. As if beauty exists not only in our estimation of it, but as a form of itself. As if created by a transcendent artist. Nature has a explanation in a physical sense, in terms of scientific inquiry. But the beauty of nature and beauty is transcendent from that explanation. Therefore, it must have a transcendent explanation or cause. It is not a physical explanation. It's as if beauty itself is telling us of a hand that created it. People find different things beautiful. However, there is beauty in the things people find differently beautiful still. That might seem like a bit of artistic jargon, but just unpack it and you'll see that it makes sense. So therefore, does nature have an intrinsic beauty, and everyone subjectively reacts to it, regardless of the difference of what we find beautiful? Nature itself, still exists with those exact qualities that we might subjectively find beautiful, like a sunrise, a new start, a new beginning, a new day, a new chance. The essence of a sunrise or of a sunset exist independent of our subjective emotional opinion of it or reaction. Some might react to sunset or sunrise with less or more emotion, but the intrinsic essence of it exists. Plato, to quote him, said this, quote, "Beholding beauty with the eye of the mind, he will be enabled to bring forth not images of beauty, but realities. For he has hold not of an image, but of reality, and bringing forth and nourishing true virtue to become the friend of God and be immortal, if mortal man may." I think it seems to me it would be to do beauty and the beauty of nature injustice to not give it transcendental meaning, not to say that it's from a higher hand. This section of the video, I'd like to share a book with you guys, and it's by a world-renowned theologian, and it's to do with the study of natural theology, which is to do with how we can see the existence of God in nature and in the beauty of nature. So I thought I'd bring you a book that you can look at, and it has an absolutely stunning review at the end, and I'll let you guys read that because it's quite long. But it's really good, and I suggest you read it. But I'll read the description. Reimagining Nature is a new introduction to the fast-developing area of natural theology. Written by one of the world's leading theologians, the text engages in serious theological dialogue whilst looking at how past developments might illuminate and inform theory and practice in the present. This text sets out to explore what a properly Christian approach to natural theology might look like and how this relates to the alternative interpretations of our experience of the natural world. Alistair McGrath is ideally placed to write the book as one of the world's best-known theologians and a chief proponent of natural theology. This new work offers an account of the development of natural theology throughout history and informs of its likely contribution in the present. This feeds in the current debates about the relationship between science and religion and the humanities. Engages in serious theological dialogue, primarily with Augustine, Aquinas, Barth, and Brenner, and includes the work of natural scientists, philosophers of science, and poets. So, good description there of how it delves into the history of and explains what natural theology is actually about, and which is for all readers to engage with, and it deals with natural scientists and philosophers of science, which people from a agnostic or atheistic background, it caters to that audience as well, which is good, and it's a quite extensive book. And Alistair McGrath is a world-renowned theologian, and he's written many a books, and so he's currently a professor of science and religion at the University of Oxford, and previously a professor of theology. So again, like I said, the review is quite long, so check that out.